and welcome to this week's edition of the Ride Along Radio Show. Today is Thursday, December 22nd.
That's right. It's almost Christmas.
And I want to say this is show 58, 59, something crazy like that.
Wow.
We're almost at 60 shows in the can. Man.
Look at us.
I know. Look at us. And we were young when we started.
Yeah, my hair was jet black. Interestingly, it was jet black when I started.
Yeah, mine was too. I mean, you can't really see.
Well, yours still is.
What I have left. All right. So, hey, I'm George Holt.
And I'm not.
He's not. He certainly is not.
I'm Gil Contreras.
And this is Ride Along Radio. Hey, this is a show where we try to give you our perspective. You have two law enforcement veterans here. We've been around for a long time. We have both worked in various aspects of the business, in various capacities. And we're here to give you the benefit of our training experience and informed perspectives.
Correct.
As we go about interpreting the news stories of the day and examining the controversies of the day.
And that's the most important thing. You know, the perspectives that we're offering are not uninformed. We didn't read this in a book, in a class, on a college campus.
We didn't pull it out thin air, reading
in a safe space. Nope, we didn't do that. Tell you that right now.
Exactly. So that's why hard-earned experience.
You may not like it. You may not like the perspective because it's not politically correct. There's no filters. We don't have to hold anything back. I certainly don't hold anything back, if you know me by now. And you're going to get the straight stuff from a police officer's perspective, not from an activist perspective. No. not from a liberal perspective. No. You're going to get it from a police perspective.
And hopefully that's why you tune in. Hopefully you tune in to hear our perspective. Because if you want to hear people sit around and talk a bunch of uninformed nonsense about some of these stories, you could just watch mainstream media.
Or you could switch to Urban View, Black Hate Talk Radio, Channel 124. Oh, check that. Channel 126, SiriusXM.
I just got my SiriusXM subscription renewed, so I don't know which channels to blast Gil about. But whatever Fox News is, like is it 117 or something like that?
It's 114. It's 114.
114.
If you want to know.
I'm sure he – see, he knew. I knew he was going to know.
But, you know, actually 124 POTUS is an excellent channel for political analysis. I love that station. I listened to it before briefly,
but I don't know. It didn't.
I listened to Urban View though, just because.
That's Karen Hunter.
Karen Hunter, Joe Madison.
Joe Madison, the Black Eagle.
The Black Eagle. There's another guy named Dr. Wilmer Leon. He's on the weekends over there.
What about the guy who was Ben Carson's guy? Something Williamson.
Yeah.
He's got an unusual first name.
It's a first name. He's got a last name for a first name.
Adam something or something.
No,
like that.
Anderson. No, not.
Anyway, that guy.
He's on there.
Armstrong Williams.
Armstrong
Williams. Yeah,
we know. And it's funny because he's after Karen Hunter.
Right.
So you hear all these nuts, and then you hear
the other side of it.
Then you hear what's his name, Armstrong, and Armstrong's caller. You know, Armstrong he does it differently. He lets people call in, and even sometimes I'll listen and I go, this person doesn't know what the hell they're talking about.
He still lets them talk.
He just lets them talk, and he said, "Thank you for your opinion," and he's very kind.
Well, that's good though.
He's kind. No, actually, it's not.
Well, it's good in that he's allowing other people to come on. Okay, you remember how Wally George used to be, and how not the dope fiend. What's his name?
The dope fiend.
Rush Limbaugh, not him.
Ah!
There was another guy on conservative talk radio who just like, man, he likes to shout people down and won't let people get a word in edgewise. I forget that guy's name.
I don't know who you're talking about.
There's a bunch of them. But anyway, I don't like listening to those guys because you won't even let that person talk. It's like some people tune in to hear all the arguing. I turn that off.
I think a lot of people that watch our show later, they do listen because they want to be angry with mostly what I have to say.
Yeah.
So
you're the one who's mostly wrong.
Well, if you look at it from a black activist perspective, I'm dead wrong for God's sakes.
Bow to the people.
Right. But I'm not, so yeah. But I think there's something about that. The give and take of the because for a cop you're pretty you're a progressive for God's sakes, and you're
I'm not. I'm just right down the middle, man. I'm conservative about it. I got some things I'm liberal about.
You're not down.
I don't subscribe to one ideology or the other, man. I'm a free thinker.
You're like the Leaning Tower of Pisa. You lean to the left.
It depends on what side you look at it from, though. People tell you the Leaning Tower of Pisa leans to the right. Depends on what side you're looking at it from.
Yeah, well, you lean to the left. So
but if you and Trish would tell you I lean to the right. Well, see how that works?
Trish would be wrong.
So you're right. I am the Leaning Tower of Pizza. Which way I lean depends on where you're standing.
Trish is way out there.
See?
And then you're
and
just,
to her, I'm leaning to the right.
You're to the right of her. You know, it's hard to
and I'm to the left of you.
You're the very far left.
And you guys are polar opposites, so I'm right in the middle.
Negative.
Clowns to the left of me, jokers to the right.
Here I am.
Stuck in the middle.
But can I just say, before we get into the show, there's been a very interesting thing that I've noticed on my Facebook page. And I have a lot of friends, and I have friends from different sectors of my life. So
sure.
Yeah, I'm also a musician. People don't know that, but you know, I play guitar.
There
play
are percussion. So many layers to this, dude, that you would be surprised. Those people who just watch to hate on Gil, or they want to give him, if you knew who this cat really was, you'd be ashamed of yourself for some of the hatred you spew.
No, you wouldn't. But it doesn't matter.
You should be.
But you know, I have my very lefty friends. I have my very right friends. I have my cop friends.
Right.
And then I have my musician friends, and so I have a pretty wide range of, and since we've been doing this, I've been getting more and more friend requests just because the stuff that I post and the commentary that I put on there.
Sure.
But I noticed after the election, and then especially after the Electoral College voted on Monday the 19th,
right.
After that vote came out, and of course, you know, it was like we all thought it was going to be. Some of the smartest people that I know, and these are people that not from, you know, from Facebook, like people actually know.
In real life. Real life people. Sure.
Yeah.
Real life friends.
That were friends and are still our friends, but have just lost their damn mind over this election.
But did they think that the Electoral College was really going to – they were holding out hope for that?
They were.
That's incredible to me.
But not only that, there was one person posted on my page and – it was in a thread, so it's not on my page, but it's in a thread that I was commenting on that was actually on his post. And here's what he said, and this really blew my mind. He really believes that Donald Trump, that the whole election and the Electoral College is all corrupt. And Donald Trump was placed by – I'm not sure who, but he was inferring the GOP – was placed – as the president-elect, and then once he's inaugurated, they're going to let him do something. He's going to do something wrong, and then they're going to impeach him, take him out, and install President Pence. And that all along, that was the plan.
Okay. I do not agree that the Electoral College is corrupt in that sense, because your friend wouldn't be saying that if Hillary Clinton had won. Okay.
Right. They'd all be happy.
But I have heard that was kind of the thing let's get this other guy in here who's a stable kind of a guy, more GOP centric kind of a guy, because every conservative knows Donald Trump isn't really a conservative.
Correct. And that's not what people were voting for. The reason Trump won is because the establishment Republicans and the establishment Democrats have all become so corrupt and in the same millionaires club that they have left the American people out of it.
Well, he's in the billionaires club. That's even more exclusive.
Well, it is, but they know how to do one thing. At least they know how to do one thing, and that's make money.
Sure.
And so what America was voting for this time was a change. They just want something different, because there's a huge portion of the country that is ready to take this Etch-a-Sketch and shake it up, because what we have hasn't worked for anybody. It hasn't worked for the working class for the last 40
years. But keep in mind,
though, for the last 40 years.
You're right. The people who voted for him are ready for a change. But this plot that your friend is talking about is not being perpetrated by the people, if it's being perpetrated. It's being perpetrated by the GOP establishment. They wanted to have somebody in there, I think, as a backup. So when this guy wrecks into the wall, then at least our man steps in and he cleans up. And I don't think Donald Trump is a guy that you have to set up. I think you let Donald Trump do Donald Trump, and Donald Trump ruins himself.
Well, I don't think so. I think everybody's going to be very surprised at what he's going to be able to accomplish. And a lot of it is going to be good for the country. It's going to be good for business. It's going to be good for taxpayers.
It's going to be good for taxpayers?
Absolutely. And the left is
from the guy who's not a taxpayer?
Please, let's not get into
it. I'm just saying.
I mean, that's ridiculous.
I can't let you run wild now and just say whatever. Now, you know, the dude's talking about he don't pay any taxes, so he's going to care about the taxpayers now?
He was working within the law.
Which taxpayers?
Within the tax code that allows him to write off a law.
I didn't say he broke the law. I'm not saying he broke the law.
That's right. So, I mean.
He gamed the system.
If he did, well,
have we seen his tax returns yet? By the way,
no. I don't care. Right. I don't care about his. I don't care about yours. I don't care about the POTUS. I don't care. I only care about mine. That's why I have a tax.
But he's going to be in charge of yours. That's why he's going to have an impact. My tax return on me and what I think about taxes will never have an impact on you. What POTUS thinks about taxes will never have an impact on you. We're talking about a guy who is going to design this to benefit him and people like him, and that's why I don't understand people who are in the bottom 2%, bottom 1%. Supporting blindly those who are in the upper 1%. Because those people are going to look out for themselves, first and foremost, and that Millionaires Club. Okay. You don't think so? You don't think the rich people look out for each other? You heard that term about the rich staying rich and the poor staying poor?
Okay. When we get into the weeds like this, there's no comeback to, but this dude doesn't pay taxes. He pays more in taxes than you and I will pay in a lifetime. For all the businesses, you know,
or percentage-wise, or dollars and cents,
Okay, it'll be 100 times more than we'll ever think of paying. So,
well, let's back up though. But what impact? Look at his footprint. His footprint's a lot larger than ours too, right?
That's right.
Okay, yeah. So then he should pay more in dollars and cents, right? He's using a larger proportion of a whole bunch of different subsidies and all kind of stuff you and I will never be eligible for. So don't look at it. That's why you got to go on percentage.
That's what we're – no, you don't go on percentage because
you don't go on percentage, your tax bracket is based on what?
If you say –
a percentage.
If Warren Buffett says, wow, you know, my secretary pays more in taxes than I do.
He means percentage.
She pays a higher percentage in taxes.
He means percentage, sure.
Yeah. She does not pay more money than he does in taxes
right.
in any given
not
year.
Not in dollars
and
in
will
cents.
Not, and will not in her lifetime,
but
for
percentage
God's
is what matters to the individual person.
Okay.
The percentage is what matters, and that's your proportionate contribution.
This is who we can't help. We can't help you guys. But you're going to benefit anyway. Your business is going to benefit.
And that's the difference. See, because I'm not an ultra conservative, I actually have compassion for people outside of my own situation. I will do fine under Donald Trump. The people in my tax bracket and the people who are in my industry will do quite well.
Mm-hmm.
It ain't me I'm worried about. So I'm just showing a little compassion here. It ain't me I'm worried about. I'm worried about the other people who don't follow my tax bracket, who are not in my industry.
So that's
those people are going to suffer.
That's why you make these silly tax arguments. You don't pay no taxes.
Well, that's not silly. It's true.
I mean, it's ridiculous.
He bragged about it.
It's just ridiculous.
He bragged about it. He bragged about getting out of taxes. He's dodging a tax man.
Do you have a tax guy?
I do.
Okay. Do you try to minimize your tax liability?
Sure.
Of course you do.
Not to the point where I don't pay nothing.
It's the same thing. If you could pay nothing, you would.
If they asked me to release my tax returns, I would.
If I could pay nothing, I would.
If they asked me to release my tax returns, I would. If I was trying to gain the trust of the people, I would. And that's why he wasn't able to get the trust of the majority of the American voters. More facts. Sorry. Oops. Inconvenient fact night.
Yeah. It means absolutely nothing.
Well, it doesn't now. You're right.
That's like a football game. You say, but we got more yardage. We should have won. But it's points on the board.
You're right.
You know, it's electoral college that counts. For
you're
God's
right.
Sake.
That's what counts. But let's not act like the dude's got a mandate because he doesn't. Let's not act like the majority of people trust him because they don't.
He got a mandate from this people who live in the states in the electoral college. Right. California, New York, Massachusetts. You know,
all those rich states that can stand alone on their own without the flyover country.
California is not quote rich close quote.
You kidding me?
This state is doing so bad. LA County,
in the words of Sweet Wonka Willie Joe, you better crack open a book. My God, man, read something.
You better take a look at what's happening.
Willie Sweet Wonka Joe. I'm sorry.
The state of California has turned from the Golden State to the Pewter State, and it continues down this progressive rat hole. And, more and more cities like Los Angeles and San Francisco are jumping on the bandwagon. And, I can't wait to get out of this place. California, there's a good portion of California that wants to secede. And I wish they would, because it's like a foreign country here to me. I just want to go somewhere else.
A lot of people are leaving.
Of course they are.
Ron Williams used to say, last person out of California, turn the lights off.
Yeah. Well, there's not going to be a last person. There's always going to be progressives, and
always going to be people who are free livers, free thinkers, who have compassion for others who occupy the state.
Who want the state to continue? Yeah, California voters are ridiculous. They never met a tax they didn't like. It's just ridiculous. I'm so tired of paying for shit. I can't tell you.
Like Trump,
and I have got zero, zero, settle, nada, Nathan, nothing,
nada, zilch.
So anyway, my point was, before you took us on.
Before
a,
I shine the light of truth. Before I shine that illuminating light of truth on the subject.
Before you took us on, you know, into the weeds on some tangent. The point I was trying to make was that I've been surprised at the, you know, that narrative about, you know, this big evil conspiracy to install Pence at some point. And then the other one is, Russia. Russia, that's right.
Russia did it.
Everything, the Russians. So yeah, Putin's Russia coming, it's Red Dawn, and it's Red Scare 3, apparently, and, you know, jeez.
Let's see how that unfolds. Let's watch that one. Let's see how that unfolds.
I just find it interesting that, you know, some of the smartest people I know have moved into the tin hat foil or the tinfoil hat club.
Well, we had other people who were pretty smart. They're not here tonight, so I'm not going to mention their name. I think they're at their bunker in Arizona tonight. Who wear a tinfoil hat too? Got a real thick Reynolds wrap aluminum foil, not the cheap stuff. He got that real thick stuff.
Yeah.
Listen.
But you guys got the cheap stuff from
99-cent store.
Yeah. It tears real easy.
It tears real easy.
You just get more. Just get more. It's only 99 cents.
All right. Exactly. So listen, we usually get into our, and by the way, the hotline number is 323-293-3375. Tonight marks the return, albeit temporary, of intern Darren, who's on his school break. And so he's back in the booth next to the POTUS, answering calls and stuff when you call in at 323-293-3375. So we get into our social media feedback. Go ahead.
What school does intern Darren go
That's
to?
That's OPSEC, but he goes to a California State University.
Oh, okay. Intern Darren, I wonder if... are there safe spaces over there for you? If there's no safe space?
No safe space.
What?
No safety pins on the shirts or nothing?
Oh, my God.
Well, he was taught how to create his own safe space years ago.
I hope he was.
So he's all right.
All right. I'm just wondering because, you know, academia has lost its goddamn mind. They turned tinfoil as well.
So here's our social media feedback. We had one comment that I thought was...
From last week?
From last week's show. And this is from Willie Sweet. Wonka Joe.
Oh, man.
Because we're talking about the militarization of police, right? It's one of the things we covered.
Right.
Will Donald Trump honor his promise to once again authorize surplus military equipment to go down to local law enforcement, to trickle down?
Mm-hmm.
And Willie Sweet Wonka Joe has a one-word statement. That's the smallest statement he's ever made.
Uh-oh.
We need police in society, he says. What we don't need is a goddamn police state. And I think a lot of people feel that way in terms of that fine line. We even had Trish call in and say that she supports the militarization of police because people understand. And again, she was around during North Hollywood. The police have to have a higher level, the ability to have a higher level of response, because when the police don't have that and stuff gets out of hand, they're going to bring the military in. That's not what you want. Nobody wants that in this country. Years ago, it was observed to me, probably the mid-90s. By a guy who just got out of the Marine Corps and came to our agency. He said he was observing, remember in the mid-90s, we didn't have any conflicts going, that the military was coming down.
Well, we did. They were just being ignored by the Clinton administration.
Well, yeah. We had Mogadishu, et cetera, right?
And
but there were no large-scale conflicts is what I'm saying.
You know, we had
most of our military wasn't getting any trigger time.
10 opportunities to capture or kill Osama bin Laden in the two Clinton terms, and he chose not to. And then, of course,
he was our guy at the time, right? He was fighting them. He was, he's rolling with the Mujahideen?
No,
fighting the Russians?
That was in the 80s. That ended in 89, sir.
Okay, but I'm just saying, he was still on the kind of on the good guy list, right?
No, he wasn't. He was on the terrorist list.
At that time already?
Yeah,
allegedly he was on the
terrorist list. CIA had a whole unit. It was called the ALEC unit.
He was put out there, right. It was put out there that he was on a terrorist list.
He was thought of as a financier of terrorism, and then later, you know, he created...
But it was cool when he was our guy doing the same thing, just like Fidel Castro, right? It was cool as our guy at first, now he's a bad guy.
No.
He was
not, quote, our guy, close quote.
Let me get back to the thing about militarization of police.
I used to teach this. I taught Homeland Security, for God's sake.
Okay, well, I read too, though. So, all right, look. So, you got me off track with that. Oh, there was no trigger time, no large-scale conflicts. Most people in our military were not getting trigger time. And so he was pointing out that the military's mission was becoming more of a peacekeeping thing, which was Somalia was initially.
Mm-hmm.
The military was kind of scaling down, but that law enforcement was ramping up because we had the drug war.
Well, the military wasn't scaling down. The Clinton administration was scaling down the military.
Well, for whatever reason, it was happening.
Yeah, right. But that's the whole point.
The military doesn't have the ability to scale itself down. It has to. You've got civilian oversight still.
That's right. And so the Clinton administration was scaling back the military. Was scaling back the intelligence apparatus, and that coupled with all
he was referring to operational tempo. He wasn't talking about manpower. He's referring to the mission and the operational tempo, in that there was a lot of peacekeeping going on in the military, whereas law enforcement was getting more militaristic. Automatic weapons were becoming more widely available to law enforcement.
Right.
Armored vehicles and specialized training. Now it can be told. When I was a police officer in Los Angeles, and I think you were down there for this, we went down to Camp Pendleton and did some training with Force Recon. Were you there when we
did No, that? I didn't go down there for that.
Yeah, we went down to Camp Pendleton and did some training with Force Recon. And this is, you know, cops in L.A. Being trained by one of the United States military's finest fighting forces right down in Camp Pendleton. And we were exchanging ideas with them because, honestly, at the time, we were the one doing room entries. Mm-hmm. We were the ones getting the trigger times. We were getting in more shootings than the guys in the combat arms units were,
right,
just because of where we worked and what we did. So there was this free flow exchange of ideas between law enforcement and military, and that's what led that officer to make that comment, that the law enforcement is stepping it up, military stepping it down to more like a peacekeeping kind of a role. Now we're not seeing that because now we've had two shooting wars going on for 15 years now.
Yep.
So we got a whole different military than we had 20 years ago. But so a lot of people feel that way about the militarization of police. And there was some other comments. Okay, about the militarization of police will get bigger and bigger because of the money to be made. Now, here's the funny thing about that. That was also Willie Sweet Wonka Joe. Here's the thing about that money aspect of it. There is no money made by the military industrial complex when law enforcement gets hand-me-down equipment from the military, because that equipment's already been purchased once.
Right.
And then it gets given to local law enforcement. The money would be made if there was no militarization of police from the federal government, because then law enforcement would go out and buy this stuff because they still need it. So either they'd write grants or they get asset seizure money or asset forfeiture money or something, mm-hmm, and to still get these things, because we were still getting equipment. Before there was a DRMO program, we were getting things from our asset forfeiture program.
Right.
So the money would be spent in that industry by the federal government not giving us that stuff, by getting rid of it some other way, giving it to some allied nation or something like that. So when you think about that and it's a money grab, it's quite the opposite, actually. There's no money made when hand-me-downs are given out.
Mm-hmm.
So that was that comment there on that on our show. That was the ones that were like
It's interesting the turn that this, you know, militarization of law enforcement has taken, because during the first Obama administration and then the rise of the Occupy movement, you know, that was the first time we saw, militarized law enforcement deploy on protesters, those Occupy guys.
Right.
And
right. People were surprised to see that.
Correct. And there were those of us like Kent Lee and that were on the other side of this saying, well, this is interesting, because there was a lot of speculation about the militarization of police, and then Barack Obama's wanting to create a separate federal law enforcement, a separate federal police agency. And so there's a lot of speculation, talking about tin hats, tinfoil hats.
Right.
There was a lot of speculation back then about, you know, we might say, hey, this is cool that the law enforcement is being militarized and getting all this cool stuff from the military to use and the training and stuff. However, what do we do if it gets turned on us? It's one thing to watch the Occupy movement get, you know, flashbangs thrown at
yeah, but they're still American citizens, and if they can do it to them, they can do it to you.
Right. And so because there was a time when, you know, one of the things that Obama's has pushed for and has failed, thank God, has been gun control. And so as this push for gun control was very strong, especially after Sandy Hook in 2012.
So that was a push for gun control, or that was a push for like universal background checks, et cetera?
No, it was a push for gun control, guns. They want to take guns. So
really, I still got all mine.
Yeah, I know. That's why
I said
more,
actually. Now
that's why I said he failed, and I said, I said,
you did say that, but
and
I don't think
I said,
he didn't try.
And yeah. I said, thank God. Well, he can't. You know, there's this funny document, the Constitution.
Right.
God
he's
dang
the
it.
Man with the constitutional law professor. He knows. He taught the document.
Yeah.
At the college level, he knows.
He keeps getting in the way for God. He said, boy, if it weren't for this document, why I could really make this a great place. But anyway, there were sheriffs around the country who were writing open letters to the president saying, if you use executive order to do additional gun control and you try to come to my county and enforce it, we're going to stop you at the county line.
Right. We talked about that, because I said that they could say that, but the truth is all of these counties and cities get so much federal funding that they wouldn't want to jeopardize that revenue stream.
Well, I don't know.
That support, financial support.
Under normal conditions, I would agree with you. But that would be an extraordinary condition, and I think there were sheriffs.
Highway funds and everything.
But there were sheriffs who would say, hey, this is where we're going to draw the line here. Just like, you know, California saying, if you federal government, if you try to come here and enforce immigration laws, we're not going to let you.
Well, what they're saying is we're not going to help you. They didn't say we're not going to let you. They said we're not going to help you. And we won't be doing your job for you is what they're saying.
Right. And we're creating using taxpayer money, at least in LA County.
Oh, yeah. $10 million.
Yeah. It's just ridiculous.
Wow. That's crazy.
So it's interesting how the conversation about the militarization of the law enforcement has shifted.
Yes.
Because back then, we were people like me were kind of for it, but we were a little bit afraid, especially because of the progressive agenda of the Obama administration, you know, which was pretty scary.
But even prior to that, let's go back to the days of Waco and Ruby Ridge. I actually just had dinner with one of the FBI agents who was involved in both of those situations. Very interesting take. But I think I mentioned that last week. But even then, there were people on that other side who were very, very concerned with what federal law enforcement was doing.
Right.
And what they had become and who was out there, blah, 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 right, at those different places. So
yeah, when you saw agencies like Bureau and Land Management, BLM.
Right.
And then you see they have a police department.
Right.
And they're all tacked out.
Oh, go to D.C. You want to see police departments? Go to D.C.
The guy's got beard.
They got beards, right. Why does BLM need that?
Whoever heard of BLM, number one, you know.
And why do they need that?
And you know, if you're going to have, you know, you have, I guess, like, you know, park rangers or something, but,
yeah,
you know,
but when you see people cooking meth and growing weed out in their lands.
Those dudes are, you know, they look high speed. I don't know if they are or not, but
they have the look. They have the beards.
Everybody.
They got the beards and the Oakleys.
They got the tactical beards.
Hey, we got one more social media question before we go to break, and this is a great one for you. And this is from Derek Hendon, who wants to know, because we showed the video on the dog, right, the dog bite. Right. Can a dog get HIV or any human biohazard?
Wow, I don't know the answer to that.
That's a good question, though, isn't it?
It is a good question.
Yeah, we'll look into that, Derek, and we'll find an answer that at least sounds right.
Yeah,
and we'll get back to that.
Yeah,
we'll
I don't know. I never thought of that.
Intern Darren, can you look that up, please? Thank you. See, the return of intern Darren. Here he is.
Or just call Greg. Or my instructor.
He may know. Yeah, exactly. Hey, call him on the break.
Yeah.
Darren says, no, a dog cannot. That's why the H in HIV is for human, I guess. And so, no, I guess a dog cannot. I guess the systems are just too different.
Oh, well, bite on then.
Go ahead and bite him up.
Bite him up. Bite on.
But that's probably because it's specifically human. But the person had something else that, you know, like E. coli or something like that, you know what I mean? And maybe that would maybe it could be transmitted, but it's not a specifically.
I've never heard of that, and you know, there's working.
I've never heard anybody's dog getting sick or anything.
Yeah, there's working dogs all over the world in all kinds of places.
We had a canine handler, one good guy. I won't say his name, but he got bit by one of the dogs, and he opened the door to the police car. Someone had come out and park where he was, and park right next to his car. So he goes over, thinking he's going to put his dog in the back of his car, and there's already a dog back there because he's opened the wrong door.
Oh.
and the dogs start fighting. He tries to separate the dogs, and one of the dogs bit him. And so that officer liked to drink a lot, okay, like a lot. And he was like the Dean Martin of the department. And the joke was, well, which dog bit him? Well, let's wait and see which dog starts staggering. And then we'll know which dog is like he's been drinking. Then we'll know that's who bit our officer there. So, no, but generally, apparently you can't do that.
Yeah, Ed in Colorado just confirmed that he'd been told that that can't happen.
And Ed was a canine handler for a long time. So there you go. There's your answer, Derek Herndon. No, a dog cannot contract human-based maladies. So, Lick, it's break time. We're going to go to break.
It is.
We'll see you guys in a second.
All right.
All right, and we're back, and that was Radio Clash by The Clash.
Boom.
For those of you who are wondering.
And in Colorado says that he learned that about the canines from Dave Reaver over at Adler Horse.
Adler Horse. You happen to be wearing an Adler Horse shirt tonight.
Yeah, and that's where my doggy came from. That's where we did dope school.
We are both trained at Adler Horse. Great facility. Trained with some really really special people out there, too. That's good stuff.
Yeah, I love, you know, we just did our research last month, and it's so cool to be able to train with cops from everywhere. You know, we have all these canine teams,
yep,
and there's me and Randa right up in it. You know,
yeah,
I mean?
Yeah, nice.
We right up in it.
That's right, doing it all.
You don't hear me, though.
There it is. There's the tagline. So listen, our news of the day. We usually try to get to that in the first segment, but we got bogged down in the weeds.
Yeah.
Talking about taxes and tax brackets and percentages, et cetera, et cetera. So here's an interesting thing, and this is, man, this is such a stunning thing, but that agency has lost some of the shine that it used to have. So I guess it's not altogether surprising. But there was an FBI agent who was, actually, let me back up. There was a suspect who was shooting at a police sergeant in Grand Rapids, Michigan. They deploy on that suspect, they prone him out, put him on the ground, and they come to find out that he's an FBI agent.
Wow.
And he apparently was in a drunken rage or a drunken stupor, which led to him shooting at the police officer. But his ass sobered up real quick when he hit that asphalt, because listen to his response here when they get up on him. So here's this video out of Grand Rapids, Michigan.
Get cover, get cover!
Secured. Empty. He's got a badge.
I will not hurt you, sir.
Federal Bureau of... He's an FBI agent.
FBI agent, sir. I will not hurt you, sir. Believe me, sir. Thank you, your man. Sir. Sir. Thank you, your man, for doing the right thing.
So, you guys probably don't think that's funny.
First of all, why has got to be Mexican?
Well, yeah, why? That's Ruben something. I forget his last name. Yeah.
Making my people look bad like that.
Hey, man, he's a pillar of the community. At least he was. At least he was. He apparently is an Las Vegas-based FBI agent who was in Michigan working on an undisclosed investigation. And I guess it was after hours, and he decided he was going to go out and knock back a few. You would think that you work in Vegas and you didn't get in trouble all that time. That's where you're going to get in trouble. As a cop, you're going to get in trouble is going to be in Vegas. I don't know. I can't tell you how many LA cops we both know that got in trouble in Vegas.
Mm-hmm.
It happens all the time, especially around late March, early April, Baker to Vegas time. A whole lot of nonsense happens with cops in Las Vegas. And this dude is stationed in Las Vegas or assigned to Las Vegas. No issues, apparently. Stellar reputation. And then they send him out there, and he gets caught up. So, you know, that guy, he was very remorseful, wasn't he? He sounded very regretful of his actions.
He sounded like a little punk. That's what he sounded like.
Here's the thing. First of all, he's lucky they didn't kill him.
That's right.
He's cracking off shots at a copper.
That's why I was thanking him for doing the right thing.
Right, exactly.
Thank you for doing the right thing.
Right, exactly. And they wouldn't even have to plant a gun on him because he had one. He just would have been smoked. I like that tactic coming up on him with that shield, though.
Yep.
Because there was no cover. He was out in the middle of a parking lot. So they used the shield to get up on him, which is good. Use that shield also as an impact tool to put him on the ground.
Yeah.
And one officer covered him while they
And then off to the side, you hear the doggy barking.
That's right.
And he's ready to do his thing.
That's right. So you can play if you want to.
That's right.
Because guess what? That dog don't care nothing about no begging or pleading. He don't know nothing about that. That's just womp, 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 womp to him. Oh, he don't know what you're saying. He gonna bite you.
You sound like Charlie Brown's teacher to him.
Yeah, womp, 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 womp. Exactly, right? So, that guy, though, beside the fact that he's clearly going to jail, that dude's whole career just evaporated.
Yep.
One thing the FBI
Right
before his eyes. One thing the FBI doesn't play about is improprieties, misconduct, that kind of stuff. They are not that sterling, shining agency that they once were, but what agency is.
Right.
But they always had that reputation of being forthright and being above any sort of reproach. And something like that happens, and it's alcohol related. And we've had FBI agents in jail. There's FBI agents in jail now for like espionage, or it was espionage, wasn't treason. The Whitey Bulger caper, FBI guy got washed up in that. We've had FBI people get in trouble over the last 10, 15 years. And now you got a guy who's out here drunk shooting at cops.
Yeah. You know, when you work
What if they killed him? Imagine that.
Yeah.
What about the scandal? Oh my God!
And think about the officer. You know, when right. you're the guy who has to live with it, you killed an FBI agent, even though he was, you know, clearly in the wrong and he was a threat.
Yeah, he would get in trouble if his intoxication led him to have contact with law enforcement.
Right.
So the producer's question was, would he get in trouble for just being intoxicated if he hadn't shot at the cop? And the answer is yes, because that's public drunkenness. He's already wrong. He had his badge on his belt, for crying out loud. So that makes you wonder, was it even after hours? Because if it was after hours, you're supposed to put that up. You should be downstairs in a hotel bar where it's safe to get drunk. Not out in the street shooting at cops in the snow, for God's sake. So, yeah, he's done.
So, fan favorite Trish Neverett Nessingham.
She says.
Chimes in and says, number one, she says, what an idiot. But the other thing she says is the video's proof that a suspect with a firearm, and then in caps, I guess she's yelling at me, does not have to die by law enforcement. Thank you.
Well, not when they put the gun away. Not when they put the gun away, they don't, or put it down or whatever. Oh, don't think that they wouldn't have smoked him if they thought they had to.
That's right.
If he gave them any provocation, he was bought and paid for already. Body camera, no body camera.
Yep.
He was bought and paid for. Fortunately, you saw how he was immediately regretful. And he was laying on the ground, basically sniveling, for lack of a better term.
Well, she's trying to feed into the false narrative. You know, I can hear the Morris Media Live Network, you know, going, oh, if that was a black man, they would have shot him. They wouldn't even wait. He wouldn't even have a chance. They would just shoot the brother. And that's what they'd be doing. That they'd be shooting the brothers. And please.
Wow. He did the impression and everything.
That's
wow.
That's what you hear on Hate Talk Radio, Sirius XM.
Well, here's the
Urban
thing.
Urban View Channel 126.
Here's the thing. You and I have both taken guns off of armed suspects.
Yes.
We have both encountered people with guns who we could have killed.
Right.
If we just had the heart and wanted to do it. If we were just some dark-hearted bastards, we could have killed a bunch of people.
I've been on people who didn't have a gun and I still could have killed them and I
right,
didn't.
Right, because they had weapons or whatever. They posed
that's
a threat.
Right.
But we've been on people who've had guns that gave us every reason, if we were just out here trying to rack up a body count, that we could have canceled their birthday right then and there. Most cops have been in that situation. We choose not to shoot more often than we choose to shoot. Never forget that. Never forget that. People are stupid and give you reason, countless reasons, countless times to use force on them. If you were just out there looking to do it, you could clearly do it quite a bit.
Oh, yeah.
So, you know.
Yeah, if you didn't have a conscience, you know, if you know the law and department policy, and you can write.
Yeah, those three things.
I write my way out of anything. I was a good writer.
Yeah.
I still am. I'm a writer, for God's sakes. I'm an award-winning journalist.
Called articulation.
I will write. You see what I'm saying?
Me too. That was always one of my strengths.
However, you still have to live with yourself.
That's right.
And,
That's right.
You know, you can write all you want to, and you can brag, and you can say, I take it to the grave. Yeah, right. You know, the majority of cops that I knew and cops that I still know who are out there, are arresting the right people for the right crimes in the right ways. You know, a million people get arrested every day and nobody gets killed.
Right. Sure.
These high profile cases.
Those are anomalies. When police officers have to kill someone, that's an anomaly. Not that it doesn't happen daily, but think of all the hundreds of thousands of contacts that happen daily and.
And I think the one thing the public doesn't realize, I really don't think they realize this, is that the majority of the general public out here is just damn nuts.
The people we come in contact with, for sure.
These people are crazy.
Yeah, people we come in contact with,
they don't
for sure.
know the law. They want to tell you how to do your job.
Right. Well, they saw a couple episodes of Cops.
Yeah, well, whatever. When you have to deal
with blue bloods,
you have to deal with these nuts on a daily basis. It's not, hey, you know, once or twice a year. Yeah. You know, if you're in a family, every family has crazy people.
Right. Sure.
Right. So, Christmas, New Year, or, you know, Mother's Day,
right, sure. Easter,
you got to be with all the crazies, you know, but for the most part, you go, okay, see you next time. And you, okay, bye. Love you. Mean it. Oh, no, I can't wait to get out of here.
Right. And then that's limited contact. You can take them in small doses.
Right. But if you're a police officer, you have to deal with the nuts every day, because the normal people are not breaking laws. Normal people aren't speeding. Normal people aren't stealing shit.
But even when you come across normal people, they're quite often victims of something. So they're still not their best.
Well, they're victims because, you know, in this group of crazy people, you have your crazy predators and then you have your crazy victims. There are some people out there, even right now, there are people out there who don't believe there's any threat. Don't believe you need.
They don't believe there's any threat to what?
To themselves, to their personal safety.
Oh yeah,
they don't believe
live in a bubble. Then
they don't believe you need to carry a gun.
Right.
They don't believe that anything bad can happen to you. If I'm just nice to people, they're going to be nice to me. Well, and so if you treat everyone the way you want to be treated, why you'll get along.
But don't care nothing about that. There's people who got
as Trisha says,
Who have mental illness. There's people who have really bad backgrounds. That have experienced so much trauma in their life, they don't even think
like
that.
But all those people really...
They just need help. They need to be understood.
No, it's just racism. That's what that is. God dang it. It's just racism. The electoral college, it's just racism, for God's sakes. That's what it is. Hillary Clinton lost. That's just racism, for
God's
sakes.
Well, that was sexism, according to them. Well, listen, let's move on to our next show, because speaking of national politics... We have another video, and I really want to get to this one because I know that we're kind of we're bunching these together. And I think this last one's going to take us a while. We're making some calls on it. But you guys may remember in March of this year, there was a Donald Trump rally, and some African-American gentlemen attended that rally, and they were being escorted out. As they were being escorted out, a Donald Trump supporter stepped up, and he struck one of them.
Boom.
Struck him in the mouth. And... they identified that guy, and they caught him, and they put him on trial. And here's the result here.
In court, okay, just tell us what happened. So this guy was 79 years old, John Franklin McGraw. He's the one who punched you. So in court, what happened when you saw each other and confronted each other?
When we saw each other, prior to court, we had a, private conversation via the internet. Which kind of, we got to understand of who we were.
Why? What did he say to you? So via the internet and email or whatever. What did he say to you during that conversation?
He basically wanted to, let me know that it was a racial thing, that he didn't threaten me. He reiterated that most of the time, but as far as people wanted to say what he was saying was scripted in court, it wasn't scripted. He actually... The things he was saying, especially about how being caught up in a political mess and everything, he actually said the same things when we were, when we were actually talking to each other.
Hmm.
So
you
it
felt
wasn't
he,
anything
you
f- that was scripted.
So he wasn't scripted. You felt he was genuine. You felt that he reached a genuine understanding of who you are and what you stood for.
Yeah, it was genuine. Even if it wasn't what people expected him to say or felt like he should have said, it was him all the way around. And, I got that feeling because we had a private conversation, and everything he said in court was the same thing he said in private, without any lawyers, without anyone else.
All right. So here's the thing with that.
What did that guy just say?
Basically, we got to figure he's not used to, he's not a public speaker.
Clearly. He's not a speaker, period.
But what he is a victim. Okay, so let's not forget that. And this is the thing that kills me about this. He gets hit in the mouth completely without provocation.
Wait a second. He was at a Trump rally trying to cause trouble.
He was at a...
And he was being escorted out.
Hold on.
Yeah, that's what happened.
Hold on. I don't care if he was at a Trump rally and he had robbed somebody in front of the police... and was being taken out by the police. That old man's job is not to step up and hit that man in the mouth. But he didn't even do anything like that. That man came. He exercised his First Amendment rights. They didn't like it. He was being escorted from the venue.
He was disrupting the event.
So what?
What do you mean, so what?
The police were handling it, Gil.
That's
that old
right.
man hit the police.
That's right.
I didn't say he shouldn't have been escorted out.
So I'm just saying he brought that on himself.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
He's a victim.
Okay. All right. He doesn't think so, but okay.
He got hit in his mouth. Because that old man did not like what he had to say. He's exercising his First Amendment rights. Old man doesn't like it, so I'm going to be violent toward him. And then...
If he was exercising his First Amendment rights, why wasn't he out front holding a sign or something?
He can be inside. First Amendment extends inside the building, too.
It is beyond debate that that man was wrong for hitting that kid in the mouth. Was the guy wrong for being there and causing trouble, trying to disrupt the event? Was he wrong for that?
Well, no, I don't.
That's 4:15 for God's sakes! What are you talking about?
Did they book him for 4:15?
I hope so.
They didn't book him for 4:15.
Well,
he was escorted out because it was private property.
Went to Los Angeles.
He was escorted off the property.
Went to Los Angeles.
So 4:15 is disturbing the peace, by the way. 323-293-3375, by the way, is a hotline. So he gets escorted off the property. As he's being escorted off the property, this old man feels like it's his responsibility, right, or just his privilege to step up and hit that boy in the mouth for no reason at all. And then when they catch up with the old man, they say, well, you know, what'd you do that for? And he basically said it felt good to shut that big mouth up. Mm. And the next time we see him, we're going to have to kill him. That's what that old man said. So they're in court, and you see the hug and the handshake is after that old man is sentenced to 1 year of unsupervised probation with a suspended jail sentence. So that man did not do 1 day in jail for that at all. When I saw that, my reaction was, if that was me, I'd have turned and hit that old bastard right in his mouth and then turned to the judge and say, well, I understand there's a special on unsupervised probation you're giving out. So can we get a 2-for-1 special? Can I get that same thing he got? And dare that judge to give me more time than he gave this old bastard to hit him.
Mm.
Because how do you do that? How do you let this dude skate like that after just completely unprovoked, he hit the man in the mouth? So, hey, you know what? Turnabout's fair play. Plus, he said he might have to kill me next time he sees me. Mm. So I fired on him. So guess what? I guess I'm going to get my 1 year unsupervised probation, right, judge?
Likely. Why?
What's the difference? Hold on. What's the difference? Here's where the rubber meets the road. What's the difference?
A young, strapping, 6-foot
black
man.
Guy. Yes, exactly. Tell it.
Punching.
Finally, the truth. Tell it.
Punching a 80-year-old white guy.
Fuck that old white man. First of all, he ain't 80 years old.
He was 79, for God's sake.
You know what? He should remember that when he hit me in my goddamn mouth. So here's my thing. I don't care nothing about that old man's age. He knew he was old when he fired on me. That dude right there, that kid, he's a better man than I am because I would have hit that old man. I'm sorry. Just when I saw that he wasn't going to be punished by the justice system, no, man, we're going to deal with this.
Well, what are you going to do? No justice, no peace?
Oh, no justice. Take this two-piece. Bing, bing. That's what was going to happen. Okay?
You'll sock him up.
But let's talk about this. Let's get a little deeper here.
Hey, you would have went to jail, for God's sake.
As you would say, bet not. Bet not. If you'd have put this old bastard in jail, better not put me in jail. Give me 1 year unsupervised probation.
After you punch a guy right in the middle of
right in court.
Of the courtroom?
Right in court.
Yeah.
Check this out.
You'd be remanded. Bailiff.
Okay, good. So then we can talk about that later when I come out, because you can't give me that much time. But here's the thing. And you say that white privilege doesn't exist. I think I've heard you say that before, right?
It's ridiculous.
Okay, then you tell me, if white privilege does not exist, why did this old white man feel comfortable to hit this black man in the mouth in front of tens of thousands of witnesses, including the police? Why did he feel comfortable? He felt comfortable that he could hit that man in the mouth and nothing would happen to him. And the fucked up part is, he was right.
I don't think he felt comfortable. I don't think he thought this through. I don't think he said, you know what? I'm a white guy. I could probably get away with this.
Oh, he didn't think about it. He's already in him.
They're not
going to
do nothing to me. I think I'm going to just sock that big mouth when he walks by.
Because he got 80 years of thinking that way. That wasn't a conscious thought he put together. He's got 80 years of thinking that way.
Because I can get away with it because I'm white. Please.
Well, he was right. Was he wrong? And then he had the nerve to brag about it, to say, yeah, it felt good to hit him in that big mouth. Hell, next time we see him, I have to kill him. That's what he said. And that's not white privilege. Did you assault somebody right in front of police and have no fear of repercussion? And it turns out you're right.
If you watch the video, the cops didn't even know it happened.
No bullshit. I watched it a couple of times because I wanted to make sure. There was cops in front of the suspect. Not the suspect. The protester was being escorted out. There was cops in front of him, and there was cops in back of him. And they saw it happen. And they did not go back and get that old man until later, when they made him go get him, because there was such an outcry about what would happen to that old man. And then they identified who he was, and then they went and got him. Mm. So that old man hit that dude in the mouth, basically, and went home that night. No repercussions, had the nerve to talk to the news about it. And then when they do catch him, he don't get no time.
Well, CNN
not even spend a night in jail.
CNN loved it. You could even see in the interview with that guy who, you know, could barely get a word out there. But you could see the look of, like, oh, man, this is not what we wanted. We didn't want him to be all conciliatory and talk
well, like
good
I said,
about
man,
the guy.
He believing in Jesus real hard or something, man, because he was real conciliatory. And like I said, God bless him, man, because I couldn't have done it. I'm sorry.
God bless him.
God bless him.
Please.
You know?
Praise the Lord.
Yeah.
That's like I say.
Hey, you know what?
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you,
but
Jesus.
But it'd just be my luck. I hit that old man. He busts his head open on the corner of the table or something. And now I'm looking at a manslaughter beef or something.
Felony.
So, yeah.
And there you go.
That's okay.
There you go, upstate.
Yeah, I know.
So, right? Hey, where you, intern Darren, where your daddy at? Oh, he up north right now.
Like, that's how my college-educated son talks, right? Yeah.
He up north right now. He'd be back, though.
That's okay. Everything will be cool till I get back. So, listen.
My God. Hey, speaking of you getting back.
Yes.
You're supposed to be leaving the country.
I know.
So, I think I was going to hold the keys to the Mercedes-Benz.
Well, I was going to give you the older one, but then my daughter's back from school, so she's driving it now. And I can't give you the brand new one. I don't even have 1,000 miles on it yet.
Yeah, well, I'm going to need the keys. So I almost forgot.
Well, I figure like this.
Thank God you said something.
Since Donald Trump reneged on so many of his campaign promises, I figure I could just renege on mine, too. You call it rhetoric, right? Campaign rhetoric.
It was campaign.
Okay, so that was rhetoric on my part, too. So since Donald Trump is not going to build the wall, he's not going to repeal Obamacare, and he's not releasing his tax returns, I figure I don't have to move to the Bahamas.
Oh, well, I think the wall is coming, and I think there's going to be some adjustments to Obamacare.
That wall ain't coming.
Build that wall.
Build that wall. Hey, listen, here's another one before we go on break. Here's another good another good story. And this is actually, it's a foreign deal, but it involves the police. And this was kind of a shocker. I don't know that we've seen anything happen like this in quite some time. The Russian ambassador to Turkey was speaking at an art gallery in Ankara. Ankara is the capital of Turkey. And it's a major city in Turkey. And he was... at the opening of this art gallery, and he was a dignitary, and he was going to speak, and he was starting his speech, and then this happened.
Time shocking violence at the opening of an art exhibit in Turkey as Russia's ambassador to that country is gunned down while making a speech, a vicious act that's being described as terror.
The video is stunning. 1 minute, a Russian diplomat is standing at a podium speaking. The next, he crumbles to the floor, his body riddled with bullets. Shot from behind by a 22-year-old Turkish policeman, shouting, "God is great. Do not forget Aleppo. Do not forget Syria." Andrei Karlov, Russia's ambassador, rushed to the local hospital, where he later died. The shooter escaping at first, leading to a wild scene outside the gallery, as police responding spot him running around inside with a gun. He would eventually be shot and killed by police. Turkey and Russia have been at odds over the ongoing war in Syria.
All right. That is amazing in that it turns out the assassin was a cop.
Yeah.
And not somebody who was posing as a cop, not someone who was dressed up as a cop, a legit police officer.
Yep.
He's 22 years old. Remember, we had that whole conversation about not hiring anybody before 25, maybe even 30.
Right.
The dude's 22 years old. And,
he's 22. I think he's 24. He's 24 years old.
Well, he's still
and
young.
He's been a cop for 2 years.
Okay. Okay, maybe that's where I got the second two from.
Yeah.
The dude, apparently, they found some Al-Qaeda literature in his apartment now that they've searched it. And he was off duty at the time, but he used his police credentials to get in and posed as a member of the security detail for the Russian ambassador. Mm-hmm. My question is, where was the Russian ambassador's actual security detail? Why wouldn't there be a detail on an ambassador?
I have no idea.
I mean, that's amazing, man. But beside the point.
And even if you're the team, if your team is secure this place because the foreign ambassador is going to come and make a speech or whatever. When if somebody walks up and says, "Hey, LA County Sheriff's Department," you don't just go, "Oh, okay, yeah, go ahead."
Right.
Yeah, you go, what are you guys doing here? This is our gig. You know, you send that guy to the CP and you go, "Hey, I don't know who this guy is, but he wants to come in, and so you all go down."
Yep.
You know, we won't let you in because you're
but you go over there and check in and get credential.
You don't just walk in. So I don't know how they did
that. And that's how that is dealing with the United States.
But let me tell you, a lot of the photos that I saw of the guy after he shot the ambassador.
Yeah.
You know, he's walking around and he's talking and he's pointing. But
trigger finger.
Yeah, everybody was commenting on his trigger finger discipline.
That's right. He maintained it all the way to the end. He kept that straight trigger finger. That's when I saw that. I said, that dude's legit.
Yeah.
When I saw not just the way he was dressed, but the way he held that pistol down at his side as he was yelling, I said, whoa, that's somebody who's had some training, because that's not something they don't do that on TV. So he's not just some
yeah, his trigger finger and that muzzle discipline.
Yeah.
He was down.
Yeah, exactly. So the dude was a real professional, a police officer. And it's unfortunate that he's tarnished his badge like that. But this is one of those situations where his political ideology overtook his oath as a police officer, his sense of duty as a police officer.
Right. And I'm going to tell you, we just saw this movie. We saw it on Amazon. But it's online. It's online, but it's only online. It's not in the movies or anything. And it's called Made in France.
Uh-huh. Oh, I saw you posted the thing.
Yeah, the movie is actually in French with English subtitles. But it's a very good, it's about homegrown terrorists in France who are French citizens. So that's what it's called, Made in France. Uh-huh. But it's an interesting look at how these guys become radicalized.
But they're not domestic terrorists, though. They're international. They're dealing with international issues.
Well, they're locals, though.
Right. They're local. They're French citizens born
some,
there.
Some are migrants. Some are you know, parents of or children of migrants.
Uh-huh.
And But in the movie, you know, one guy had gone to Mecca and he changed, and his girlfriend said when he came back he was different.
Right.
He
got radicalized.
He puts this cell together and he decides, you know, and what he tells his little cell, and they meet at a mosque, of course. What he tells his pals is the bosses want us to do this thing. It's coming, so
sure.
You know, so you have to be all in, or you know, so they go all in and whatever. But you know, I don't want to give away, but I just want to say it gives you a good insight into homegrown terrorism and what's happening there. With you know, we just saw it in Berlin, we saw it in Nice, we saw it in Paris. You know, we're eventually going to see it here.
Sure, it's going to be an evolution. But
it's going to look much like Fort Hood, Texas. That's going to look like that.
In San Bernardino.
In San Bernardino, you know, it's going to look like that. These guys they really do have these benign jobs, you know. Right. You know, and you, so if you want to try to understand how it happens, you should find this movie online and watch it. And the other thing is, it really busts some of the myths. You know, we have a tendency, because we see it on the news, and talk about ISIS, and he was inspired by ISIS, and ISIS put up something after Berlin saying, he was a soldier of the Islamic State or whatever.
Right.
They're not directly connected to ISIS.
They're not getting emails from ISIS.
Correct.
They're influenced.
Correct. And so it's not as this, you know, it's not this big, oh my God, this big thing that, you know, it isn't that. It's something else. And it's very simple. And because it is so simple, it's very hard to protect against. A guy like this who shot that ambassador,
right?
He comes to the country, he becomes a police officer, he works for 2 years as a cop,
right,
waiting for the right moment to make his political
statement. That's the question. So was he a cop before he got radicalized? Is that why he became a cop? Or is he a young, impressionable cop who got radicalized?
No, I think we don't know yet. But my take is, I'll bet money that he went with a mission, and you know, we can think of them as sleepers. Just
right.
Come in, blend in, do something, get into the police department, get into these different places, and then wait for targets of opportunity.
Wait till you get yourself in that position,
right?
Because I initially thought that he worked his way on the security detail. That he was a member of the security detail and that he was waiting for this. But, you know, this problem, the reason they apparently killed him, he said, hey, don't forget about Syria, don't forget about Aleppo.
Right.
There is an issue. He took exception to Russia's attempts to prop up the regime.
And all the bombings that are, you know, killing of civilians.
Right.
In the bombing strike.
And Vladimir Putin, a Russian president, says this is clearly an attempt to disrupt the Syrian Turkish Russian coalition,
right?
There, and he's basically not going to let that happen. So,
right, because the Obama administration, including Hillary Clinton, you know, when the red line was crossed in 2011,
and nothing was done,
nothing happened, and as a result of making that decision, and he kind of, you know, the president kind of took a little bit of responsibility for this in a press conference he held. I think it was last week I heard it, where he kind of said, you know, our options were, do we put troops on the ground, because that's what it's going to take. We either put troops on the ground,
right,
or we just step back and ride it out and hope it doesn't get – and it just got way worse than they ever thought it was going to.
Right. Well, you know what, man? Those funerals are tough. I did a lot of fallen soldier details, and they are – that's the real cost of this.
Yeah.
And you actually see it, you know.
Yeah. And so, you know, for – you know, I see some – you know, I've seen some things on my Facebook page and, you know, shame on America, shame on – you know, but it's from lefties. Lefties are the ones that didn't want him to do anything, for God's sake.
They want the boots on the ground. So you know what? Hey, you can't make an omelet without breaking some eggs.
That's right.
And so we have to kind of decide what
we're going
to do.
You can't have it both ways.
You can't have it both ways. Everybody seems to want it both ways, but you can't have it both ways.
They didn't want the no-fly zone because, oh, no, you put a no-fly zone, then you're going to have Americans and Russian fighters face-to-face. That's World War III, for God's sake.
Right.
Please.
That's what people were worried about. But
we're already in a world war.
It's just not the hot
against
shooting
radical
war that we
Islam.
Realized. Well, that's true. Yeah, it's just not fought on the conventional battlefield. It's asymmetrical warfare, we call it.
Right. But check that movie out, Made in France. Check it out. It's an excellent film.
All right. So listen, it is time for our final break as we head into the final stretch. So we're gonna take a break. We're gonna get back, and then we'll jump into our big story of the day. And that's probably what most of you want to call in, tweet, text, or otherwise piss and moan about it. All right, give us a call, 323-293-3375. We'll see you in a minute. All right, that was Another One Bites the Dust by Queen. For those of you who remember that, I think I was in the 7th grade when that song came out.
Mm.
Something like that. Wow. Gil already had kids, though.
Buddy.
So
I was doing the bump.
Yeah, there you go, right? To the song. Yeah, yeah.
Before we get to Little J's, you know, what you know about Little J?
Oh, my
J?
God. That's
what you know
school.
About Little J's?
Old school.
But anyway, there's one story that just caught my eye, you know, and they're actually, well, I don't know. Maybe perhaps I shouldn't laugh. I don't know, but.
Another sniveling FBI agent?
No, it was a sniveling CNN commentator who had a vaginal pat-down.
Oh, I saw that at TSA, right?
By the TSA. And it made her cry, for God's sake.
Well, yeah, she's being groped.
She made her cry.
She thought she was in the White House. Jesus Christ. Wow.
Where's Bill Clinton, for God's sake? They're grabbing my vajay.
Well, you know, and as you pointed out, you said TSA hasn't caught any terrorists. But a bunch of them have been arrested.
400, last 10 years.
Okay, so it's like any other deterrent. We can say the same thing about the Federal Air Marshal Service, that the Federal Air Marshal Service have not handcuffed or shot any terrorists since their inception in, what, October or November of 2001.
Right? It seemed like a good idea, you know what I mean?
Well, I'm not saying it's not a good idea, but I'm saying their very existence could be the deterrent. And the fact that they haven't caught any could be a good thing.
Yeah.
And so I say the same thing about the TSA. I mean, the TSA catches more drugs and guns than anything else. They haven't caught any bombs.
Right.
But they also haven't let any bombs go through that we know of.
Right.
Right? So, you know, you got to remember that. And thank God we have airport security, because that adds another layer of deterrence. All this whole thing is about deter, detect, delay, deny.
Well,
they're certainly doing that.
But I think what the critics, and I've been one of them, is the approach. And so, you know, rather than treat this CNN political commentator, you know, as though, hey, you never know, anyone could be.
Sure.
Rather than treat her, if you profile like the Israelis do,
right,
you'll be much more effective. At, you know, they do this with drugs, you know, and carriers.
Right. And that's how they catch drug.
Exactly.
That's how they catch them. Sure.
They do it all the time.
The TSA does that too.
It's an effective technique. But this idea that we have to, you know, check, you know, 320 million people and treat them as though any of them who are traveling,
right,
may be a possible terrorist.
Well,
that's too big of a task. The net is cast too wide. You have to narrow it down and get.
Well, you could
more
do
specifics.
It, but nobody wants to come to the airport 5 hours early before their flight.
And it could be done,
but there's commerce gets in the way.
And not only did this CNN reporter get groped, but you know, 2 days prior, I posted a video of a dad who posted his 12-year-old daughter getting groped.
Oh, right, you said something like that would have been you.
That wouldn't happen.
Right, right, right.
I wouldn't let him touch her. I would have demanded a supervisor, and if I didn't get, I would have called for the police. I mean, give me the airport police, get it, or the LAPD,
right,
whoever.
And let's deal with the sexual battery that I just witnessed.
That's right, because
right,
yeah. I wouldn't let him batter her. I would just not, you know, I would make my stand
right
at the TSA
right
line.
There. Here we go. Yeah. Hey, we had a comment from the chat room from Kamira's side dude. Not to be in her business, but you wish. Anyway,
what?
She's a host on the big show here.
The big show. I thought we were the big show.
Well, they're a little bit bigger than us.
Are they?
Yeah, a little bit bigger. Anyway, Kamira usually sits in that chair, as I recall.
Mm.
And the guy, he says they can put anything after the fact to blame Al Qaeda. So in other words, sure, they could go in and say, yeah, well, that guy was affiliated with Al Qaeda, whether he was or not. Sure, they could do that, but I think they'd be more interested in getting to the bottom of what really happened. Whether or not they'd want the public to know every detail, but I think they'd be more interested in that than blaming Al Qaeda. Al Qaeda is not even on everybody's radar like it should be right now. Anyway, Al Qaeda is
They're still on the radar screen, but
not like they should be, though.
Yeah. Well, I think that the more pressing problem has become the Islamic State.
Right. ISIS is clearly the more pressing threat, at least it appears to be to us, because that's who influenced San Bernardino shooters.
Correct.
Et cetera, et cetera. So, yeah. Right.
So this whole notion of immigration,
Orlando,
you know, is, you know, while we're worried, and including myself, worried about, you know, immigrants from or migrants from these, you know, these nations over there, these terror nations, you know, once you get into terrorism, counterterrorism, you find, well, they're not really coming in that way. They're already here. Or they may be like, you know, when we've had a couple U.S. citizens, you know, that's where this is going. It's going to be more local.
Well, that's what we saw in Orlando and we saw in San Bernardino. They were here already.
That's right. And so it's not going to be the.
Well, she wasn't.
It's not going to be the FBI, CIA, DIA, and it's not going to be those guys.
You alphabet soup agencies.
It's going to be the local cop.
It's going to find it, observant local cop.
The narcotics team from San Bernardino Sheriff's Department.
They're going to pick something up.
They find the vehicle and they engage. Yep. That's who it's going to be. It's always some street cop, you know, because street cops are so nosy. They go, hey, why'd he just do that?
And they're paying attention.
That's right.
That's how Timothy McVeigh got caught, was by a state trooper, pulled him over speeding. Lee Harvey Oswald was contacted and unfortunately killed the Dallas police officer. But that Dallas police officer stopped Lee Harvey Oswald as he was leaving Dealey Plaza after the assassination of President John F. Kennedy.
So
notice I didn't say after he assassinated President John F. Kennedy. I said after the assassination of President John F. Kennedy.
Uh-oh.
And if you've been out to Dealey Plaza and walked and looked at the grassy knoll and all that, and you know anything about long-range precision shooting, you know what I mean.
Yeah.
That's another story.
The third shooter. Well,
you know what? At least a third shooter, believe me. So anyway, yeah, we could put something. They could put it on Al-Qaeda, of course. They could say whatever they want, but, you know.
Whoever you know, they are.
Whoever they are.
It could be a conspiracy.
Well, it is a conspiracy.
They could be the ones who want to put Pence in place as president. So.
See, that's all part of them. It's a vast worldwide web of deceit and terror.
All run by Putin.
So here is. The our story we're following up on, the one you've all been waiting for. Apparently, a Fort Worth, Texas police officer got himself involved in a little bit of a brouhaha. I think that's how you say it in Texas.
Well, fracas. He didn't get himself into it. He had to respond to a radio call.
It was there, but he
responded to a radio call for service.
Listen, he.
He responded to a radio call for service.
It was there. He didn't have to step in it.
Did he get a radio call?
Well, let's watch the video. Let me give you a little background.
Did he get a radio call?
He did get a radio call.
Thank you very much.
Sure, but you
thank you very much.
Sure, you got to answer the radio call.
Your Honor, I rest my case.
But you got to handle it right. So,
Your Honor,
here's the situation. Apparently,
argumentative.
Son comes, little 7-year-old boy comes home with his sister. They go to the mother, say, a man just choked the 7-year-old boy because the boy littered, and the man told him to pick it up. The boy would not do it. And the man grabbed the boy, and I guess I don't know if he shook him or he choked him or he put his hands on the little boy. The boy went and told his mother. And his mother, unlike a lot of mothers I know, elected to call the police because a lot of mothers I know would have stormed over there to deal with that personally.
They would have
called the police.
Dropped their chanclas?
That's right. Or they would have got on the phone to call Ray Ray and them or something, and they wouldn't have called Fort Worth PD. And now I'm sure she wishes she hadn't called Fort Worth PD. But they called the police. Police come out, contact that subject. And then turns to contact the mother, and this is where the video picks up.
Don't yell, mama.
What's going on with you?
My daughter and son came home saying that this man grabbed him and choked him. I came around here and asked him, I said, why did you put your hands on my son? He said, oh, he threw some paper. I said, and I told him to pick it up. He said my son didn't pick it up. He defined him, so that's why he did it. Instead of calling him home, he said, but y'all don't even live here. It doesn't matter where we live. You don't have the right to grab and choke somebody's son.
That's not his wife.
No, his wife is...
Nobody. So I have a problem with that. My son is 7 years old. You don't have the right to grab him, choke him behind no paper that he threw. What you should have done, because we have been living here for years, so you know that my house is a door in between yours. You could have came to me. Don't put your hands on my son.
Why don't you get your son up a little?
He can't prove to me that my son littered. But it doesn't matter if he did or didn't. It doesn't give him the right to put his hands on it.
Why not?
Because he don't.
You are loud.
Because he don't.
This man just asked my mama why do use this white man, not have the,
Why would you ask me, why don't I teach him? You don't know what I teach him. And you don't, whatever you teach your kids don't mean that they go by your rules when they're not in your sight. Because you just pissed me off telling me what I teach my kids and what I don't.
If you yell at me, you're gonna piss me off. I'm gonna tell you.
Oh, well, you're not, okay?
They don't shoot that. We are on live. Don't grab her. Don't grab her. You're not grab her.
All right. Okay. So here's why I say this officer got himself into this situation. This, to me, in fact, I don't know what he did right in this scenario beside answer the radio call and get up and make contact with the people. It seemed that from down there, it went downhill based on what we could see here. And it went downhill for a couple of reasons. Number one, she was the one who called the police. She's the PR. Okay. Now, of course, he goes to make contact. You're supposed to get both sides of the story. Keeping in mind, there's three sides to every story. His side, her side, and the truth. He seemed to have, after talking to the suspect, the grown man who put his hands on a little kid, he then turns to the victim's mother, because the victim is a child here, and says to her, "What's going on with you?" Now, that may just be how he talks. I don't know him as a person. That may just be how he is when he deals with people. I don't know. But that's not, I don't think I've ever said that to anybody when I roll up on a scene, particularly if they're the what we call the PR, the RP, the reporting party, the person reporting. The person who called the police, basically. What's going on with you? So that probably, I know that rubbed a lot of people the wrong way, although that's not misconduct. It's not even unprofessional. It's just not the best way to handle that. But that's okay. That's one step in the wrong direction. She lays out to him what it is that she's called about and how this man has put his hands on her child because her child threw something on the ground, according to the man, and would not pick it up. And his question to her is, why don't you teach your son not to litter? Is that appropriate, Officer Contreras?
That was not the right question to ask.
Then, and it just really seemed that he was very not interested in anything that she had to say. From the first, what's going on with you, to why she just not the litter. And then she says, well, rightly, you don't know if I taught him not to litter or not. He just like your kids, you may teach him one thing, but they do something else outside of your presence. And it doesn't matter if he littered or not. Very good point. Doesn't matter if he littered or not. It doesn't give this man the right to put his hands on him. And the officer says, why not? Officer Contreras, is that right? Is that how you would have handled that?
Negative. After she told me that, the guy told me the story, instead of asking the first question, I would have said, okay, where's your son? Can you bring him out here? I want to talk to him.
Right.
And then I would have just left him, and I would have went over to the white guy, and I would have said, what happened? What'd you do? Que paso? Talk to me now.
Instead of being antagonistic to the victim's mother, the PR, why don't you teach your son not to, as if that's got anything to do with why you're here. Just like the man at the Trump rally getting hit in his mouth because he was disturbing the peace. Moot point. Moot point at the point where you get hit in your mouth by someone who has no reason to be putting their hands on you. Same thing here. I don't care if that kid dropped his drawers and took a dump out in the middle of the street. You still don't have a right to put your hands on someone else's child. So my question is, did that ever get dealt with? I wonder, did they ever go back and deal with this guy, or did this turn into such a cluster based on the woman's attitude? Now, quite naturally, she got pissed off. Mm-hmm. And quite naturally, she sparked up, and she sparked up in a way even her own daughter told her mama, mama, you're being loud, you know, calm down, because she saw that her mother was getting spun up, which is understandable to a certain extent, because she's already kind of hot that her son was manhandled or had his hands put on him by some grown man. But she did the right thing and called the police. And then she comes out here, and now the police officer is supporting the person who did that. So that's got to be a frustrating experience, right?
Yeah. I you know what I see? I see contempt of cop.
Oh, sure. He even said that. He goes, don't piss me off because you'll be going to jail.
Mm-hmm.
That's not really a section.
But he says that, by the way. But I mean, even before he said that, just his whole demeanor and his his posture as he, you know, I could see him in his head going, oh, here we go.
Right.
Another one of these Project Fluffies, you know, dang kids right. out of control, never out here mind, running around.
Never mind the fact that the kid is the victim. Right.
You at the house looking at TV, your kid out here running around the street, dirtying up the neighborhood. You know, this is why people can't have nice stuff.
This is why we can't have nice things.
I see it all happening inside his head.
This is why we can't have nice things. Right. Those are the wheels that are turning.
Right.
And he turns his back on the person.
Yeah, turns his back on the suspect.
On the suspect. Okay. And then turns to deal with the lady as if she's the one who, what's going on with you? Well, this is what happened. This dude right here just hit my son. You know, like you said, the right thing to do would have been to bring the kid out, get the kid's statement. Right, because right now it's all hearsay.
Right, because I don't know what happened. The officer doesn't know what happened. He doesn't even know if anybody ever got touched. Let's find out. He should be trying to figure out what the hell happened here, number one. And number two, is there a crime? And if there is a crime, who did it? And do I need to make an arrest or write a citation or do something?
Well, here's further proof of the contempt of cop thing. So he says, don't piss me off or you're going to jail. And she goes, well, I'm pissed off and I don't care, blah, blah, blah. So then he moves in. Her daughter, who's in the pink shirt, goes in to intercede. And she is not trying to keep the officer off of her mother. She's got her back to the officer, and she's telling her mother, Mom, calm down, because she knows that this dude is going to take her. The daughter is probably reading the situation a lot more clearly than the mother is, because she's looking at the body language, and she knows her mother.
Right, but as soon as she moved, even if she had good intentions, as soon as she moved, now she's at 148.
Well, no, what she did was she stepped in to stop her mother.
Right, it doesn't matter.
She wasn't telling the officer, get back, but let's talk about that. So now he moves her out of the way.
Right.
He moves her out of the way, and that's okay. If that's
so
what you need
once,
to do,
once you move her, mom has to go to jail.
Okay, so now he moves her. She's on the ground.
Right.
And she is sitting, she's laying on the ground this whole time. She does not get up.
Right.
She's yelling.
She probably couldn't.
But. She's yelling, but she's on the ground, essentially compliant, being physically compliant, if not verbally compliant. She's physically compliant. So then he handcuffs the mother, points a taser at somebody else, keeps them back. And then he goes over and handcuffs the girl in the pink. And I don't know what that was all about. Now, there are people who are saying on social media.
But you don't know what part's all about. Which part?
I don't know why it escalated to the point it did and why it was necessary to handcuff the daughter, point the taser at her. Handcuff her.
Oh, because the situation had become hostile. He still was there by himself. I don't know if I ever called for a backup unit or not. I don't remember seeing him do that. I don't know. I was looking to see if he had done it or not.
Yeah, I couldn't tell either. But the videos were kind of cut.
I couldn't
tell. It was
spliced,
so we couldn't tell. Maybe he did at a certain point. I would hope he did.
But once the girl in pink starts to intervene with what he wants to do, well, now that's a crime. So once he pushes her out of the way, once you put hands on people, people got to go to jail.
Well, once you put hands on them, you got to do something.
That's right. And so the reason it escalated is because now people are yelling. You can hear the person who's videotaping.
Yeah, they're incensed.
That's right. So, and we've said this a million times, out on the street, that's not where you make your stand.
Right. Sure.
That's not where you try to win your fight because you're not going to win that
fight. You can't be allowed to win on the street.
That's right. So even if the officer was wrong and even if he started it, once the girl intervenes with what he's trying to do, now it's his caper. Now people have to go to jail. And if you start getting loud and start yelling all this racist stuff and using foul language and all that, once all that starts to happen, now the officer's perceived threat level is going to go up. Now it's time for the taser to come out and start keeping people back while you're trying to deal with the person you have on the ground. So all of that, up until once the girl gets involved in the situation, it all looks reasonable to me.
Well, here's the thing. The problem is that it should never have gotten to that point. The problem is it was mishandled from the beginning.
I agree with that.
And that's what led to what we saw later. Now, in terms of, okay, Now he's committed. Now he's gone hands on. But now somebody brought up a very interesting point. And the question was, how is it resisting arrest when the arrest itself doesn't appear to be lawful? And this goes back to what you were saying. That ain't for you to decide.
Right.
You don't decide in the streets that, well, this ain't right. Yeah. So I can
you
fight.
You can't do that?
Yeah.
He can't do that.
Yeah, I can. Turn around. Watch. You get it sorted out later in court. Okay? Or maybe not even in court. You get it sorted out after you cooperate. Because guess what? The handcuffs have a key. You don't need a key to put them on. The key's for when they come off. Okay? So handcuffs can come off. So let's get it sorted out after you cooperate without you stacking up charges on top of yourself. Now, I will say that the mother's attitude did not help things, but she was understandably pissed off. Let's keep in mind that there was only one professional involved in this entire interaction.
The suspect?
Yeah, he was the best behaved person on everything.
He just watched.
Right, he just watched.
It's like watching cops.
Right, he got right. That's true. He was the best behaved out of everybody in this whole scenario. The one who started it all.
The alleged suspect. We don't know what he did.
Well, whatever, the guy. The guy back there. So, you know, that police officer is supposed to be, you know, nobody's supposed to be able to piss you off by anything that comes out of their mouth and goad you into action. That's not how it's supposed to work if you're a police officer.
Correct.
So that officer stepped outside of what he was supposed to be doing. And someone said they'll be investigating them. He's on paid leave while they investigate themselves for any wrongdoing. You know, internal department politics go like this. Had he shot and killed somebody and them admitting that he was wrong would result in millions of dollars worth of lawsuits, settlements, and legal fees, you might see them try to, if we can find some kind of way to put a positive spin on this or to kind of mitigate some of the damages here, okay. In this situation, nobody's going to get millions of dollars because of what happened here today.
Right.
It's bad publicity. And if you think that these police departments, especially an agency the size of Fort Worth, Texas — Fort Worth is a suburb of Dallas. My sister-in-law lives in Fort Worth with her family. I've been to Fort Worth a bunch of times. Fort Worth is a decent-sized town.
Mm-hmm.
So if you think an agency that size is going to go out on a limb for this one guy, you're wrong. They will fire police officers, believe me. In a situation where it's not going to hurt the interests of the agency, they get rid of that guy.
But his union rep is going to get involved, and they're going to say, okay, you know what? Maybe the things he said initially were insensitive. Let's do training. Let's retrain him.
The problem is when it leads to this, and now there's hands-on happen because you didn't handle the whole thing properly, they're going to be looking at all that.
Well, right, but nobody got tased. Nobody got hit.
Right.
You know, they got handcuffed. One lady, you know, she got taken to the ground, but she didn't get tossed to the ground. She didn't get body slammed. The other little girl, she didn't get body slammed either. They were loud and yelling and cursing.
He had to do something to take control of the situation in his mind.
Right. And when you take it in its totality, you know, you're going to say, okay, well, he probably didn't start off right. But once he decided he wanted to do something with the mom, the girl has no right to intervene. Once she does and everybody starts yelling and screaming, because, you know, I've been in those situations. And it always sounds worse than it really is because there's so many, you know,
so much yelling
three
and screaming.
It's so loud,
right.
And you're focused on what you're trying to do and you're trying to control one and you got one coming at you. It seems bigger. That's when you get
And it's
on,
overwhelming.
You know, right. Sure. And so you start to feel like, okay, I'm going to control all this.
That's when the taser comes out.
That's right.
Because people don't like that taser, that Edison medicine, something else. But again, it still goes back to, he's the one in control of the situation. Therefore, whatever happens is his responsibility.
I just think this incident is just a nothing burger.
Oh no, I don't agree with that because
I think it
led to people having hands put on them, and the original thing never seemed to get resolved.
Nobody got choked out. And,
well, they didn't get choked out, but hell, if that was Trish and your boo getting slung around like that, or getting handcuffed and getting tasers pointed at him,
I would say you better act right. You know, you don't act right, okay, you get what you get.
Well, okay, that's what you say, but let it really happen. Listen, another point someone brought up was, even if he does get terminated, he'll just be hired by another agency.
He's not going to get fired for this.
Well, we don't know what his jacket is.
No.
We don't know what his jacket is. We don't know, there's a lot of unknowns.
And it's obvious to me anyway, that just by his posture and the way he handled the situation initially, it's obvious to me, it's just how he's used to working. He's used to working by himself. They were in one-man cars. And he's just taking control of the situation.
Yeah.
And when you're out on the street every day, and this kind of goes back to what I said at the very beginning of the show about all these lunatics out there. when you deal with lunatics every day, and it's one of the bad things that happens to cops, is you tend to think everybody's a goddamn lunatic.
Oh, yeah, sure, sure. And we have to take a deep breath and take a step back.
That's right, because not everybody is a lunatic.
Right.
But if you start acting crazy and I go, I recognize crazy behavior, okay, you know, now I switch to...
Right, but you don't start off like
that. I switch to...
Everybody starts... Remember I said this...
Officer Black Glove.
Seasons ago, months ago, episodes ago. Everybody starts out with 100 points. Based on how you act, you either gain points or you lose points. But everybody should start off with 100 points. It's clear to me that lady didn't start off with 100 points in the officer's book. We have a caller. Caller, what's your name and where are you calling from?
It's the Monday Morning Quarterback.
It is Trish.
What?
Never right. Now sing them. Listener favorite.
I was just thinking that, you know, we don't ever find fault with law enforcement agents when they're out in the field and they're caught on video. You know, Gil's talking about the police, the union rep, you know, wanting to re-educate or whatever.
Retrain.
Retrain, whatever. It doesn't matter. Just like you can't train or it's difficult to retrain an Al-Qaeda operative, so you're not going to change that officer's ideology. Because that that is what's informing his decision. That's what informed him when he approached the mother and said what he said to her. You can't retrain that.
Do you think it was racial? Because this came up and on my own social media feed. That do you think that it was racial, or do you think he's just looking at he's just an asshole, for lack of a better term?
No, I think that he probably is an asshole. I don't know any nice racist. I don't know nice racist people. So yeah, if you have these,
you do. You just think they're nice. You don't know about the racist part. Go ahead.
If you know about these, if you know, for these people who hold those views, they're not nice people. So no, I think that the problem is his ideology. And he felt that he was justified in, rather than addressing the issue of somebody putting an adult choking a child, now it became about, you know, trying to take, and I just wonder, like, how much more do people have to take? You know, you want them to be calm and collected when they see a miscarriage of justice right in front of their eyes.
Well,
if it didn't turn the way that it did, there would be no videotape rolling. Therefore, that officer would have cleared that scene. Nothing would have been done to the gentleman to the guy who choked the child.
We still don't know if anything was done.
That's right. We don't know if the kid was ever choked.
Nothing is going to happen. Let me ask you this, Trish. You guys just played out the scenario, and you guys go. You've many months now. You've been, you know, sort of like act like clairvoyant. You know, you can sort of guess what's going to go to trial, what's not, what the outcome's going to be. But now all of a sudden you want to be like modest and like, oh no, we don't know what's going to happen.
Well, we just said he was wrong. Both of us said he was wrong. Both of us said he mishandled that call.
We both said
he mishandled it.
Yeah, and people are just sick and tired of it. And so, unfortunately, you're just going to have more police officers ambushed in the field. It's a ridiculous.
Well, let's keep in mind, nobody got killed here. This isn't Alton Sterling. This isn't a Philando Castile. Nobody got killed here. The officer clearly engaged in misconduct.
Thank God nobody got killed. You guys say that as though, like, well, that's the silver lining. Nobody got killed. Nobody got tased.
Well, no, we talk about officers being ambushed. Officers are not being ambushed in response to ass whoopings. The officers are being ambushed in response to police killings.
Yeah, well.
But I think the officer forgot what he was there for.
I think you're wrong. I think you're misreading the general public, particularly people in vulnerable communities. I think you're misreading their frustration. If you think that the only thing that's leading to ambushes is officer-involved shootings, I think you're wrong.
Well, let me tell you that that's what's getting publicized. And when people carry these ambushes out, that's what BLM was founded. BLM wasn't founded on an ass whooping, or else we would have had BLM back in Rodney King days. Okay. BLM was founded as a result of these killing shootings.
BLM was always in the making. You could argue that BLM was in the making over the last, let's say, since 1992, since Rodney King.
Well, listen, but that's the problem, is that it started way before that. This is what I'm saying. Ass whippings were issued by the police on a regular basis in the 60s, 70s. And into the late 80s, probably early 90s. Rodney King was 90, 91.
Whenever when Gil was at HPD, that's when they were doing ass whipping. So it's really not.
Well, don't say they. I was there too. 25 years ago. Don't say they. I was there. You know. Uh-huh. So listen, people were getting ass whipped on a regular basis, and it wasn't that people were being selected at random for beatings by the police.
Right.
It was the police just had a little more free rein on discretion on that kind of thing, and people didn't second guess the police.
The difference now is that there's social media. Nobody had video. Very few people had video cameras,
right?
Because the technology was so expensive.
Sure, sure. And the only reason we know about Rodney King is because of videotape.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know.
Sure, but what I'm telling you is, people understand that police brutality is one thing, but people weren't talking about police murders, like that term around it, which is very, very rare, by the way, that a police officer actually has murdered someone.
Right.
That's very rare. But that didn't start happening and it didn't start being recorded and put out there until recently. And that's why the rise in ambush killings is because of that.
Well,
it's not because of
ambush. And if I may add, this whole false narrative of racism within the police department as being the driver for officer-involved shooting involving unarmed black men is just ridiculous. But when people like you, Trish, who actually believe this nonsense, when it's perpetuated by the White House and other activists, and they're reading books about it, and they're reading books about the 50s, and they go, oh, my God, this is just like today. Oh, my God, it's still happening. It gets everybody worked up into believing something is true that isn't.
Those who don't know their history. What's the rest of it, Trish? What's the rest of the sentence, Trish? Those who don't know history.
And you won't know, you won't even understand police work until you put on a uniform and go out onto the street and try it. Once you do that, then you'll understand what street cops are facing on a daily basis.
Mm-hmm. Hey, you don't sound very engaged. You sound like you're just kind of blowing us off here.
A little bit.
Well, you didn't call in to ignore us.
Well, let me just say that Ed in Colorado just sent me this thing, and I just want to read it real quick.
Hey, Trish, thank you for the call.
Wait, Trish, hang on a second.
Okay, so because
this is for you, and it says, "Hey, the perfect Christmas gift for your sister is a complete psyche valve." So,
wow,
that's Ed in Colorado, Trish.
That's actually scary. Those we don't agree with them, so let's turn them in for re-education.
Well, I had to post. Mm-hmm. You know, I had to post earlier about how when she was dropped as a kid on her head. So,
yeah.
But then somebody called me brilliant, and
that was Seymour who called you brilliant. She said, "Yeah." She said, "You got dropped."
I'm brilliant.
Yeah,
that's funny. Yeah,
Trish, when a damn nut says you're brilliant, that's not much of a compliment.
Wow, okay? Gil, you're asking for it because Seymour stays with her fist balled up. Stand by. She's coming for you.
Hmm.
All right, Trish.
Bye, guys.
Appreciate it.
Merry Christmas, George.
Merry Christmas, and happy Kwanzaa to you.
Oh, Jesus. For the love.
Bye. All right. And that was Baby Sis Trish, viewer favorite. Trish Navarrete, now sing them.
Yeah, she's a fan favorite, apparently.
A fan favorite. She's
Isn't that
a
something?
Listener, a viewer favorite.
Mm-mm-mm. She a damn nut, but, you know.
So, the next time we see you guys, it will be... after Christmas, it'll almost be.
But I think
new year.
One thing we should do is we should follow up with Fort Worth. You know, probably have.
Oh yeah, to find out what happened with that.
Sure. Just find out what the hell happened. We saw the video. We only saw one part of it, so we don't really know what happened.
Right.
We don't know after the. You know,
other. And we'll get a little more on that because it just hit. I believe it just hit today. So
yeah,
it's there'll be more unfolding about that.
It's at least worth following up on. And my bet is it's a nothing burger.
Well, you know, let's see what happens. I like to see that officer explain his actions. You know, you can only be a dickhead for so long in this job before it catches up with you.
Yeah, you can be one for 20 years and be all right.
Well, it'll catch up with you, though. You won't have the career you would have had, young officer, if you're watching. This is from someone who was a sergeant at two agencies. It'll catch up with you eventually.
But,
so it's just better just not
to be
a dick.
But one of the things we have to keep in mind is that the way policing is done in California, especially Southern California, the way policing is done and trained here in California is very different than other parts of the world. So.
Right, but we've always been a leader since how long? We've been a leader in policing trends forever.
So
what we're doing now is the way they're going to be doing it in 5 years.
Well, maybe or maybe not. But Fort Worth, they have a way that they do, and this guy's obviously been – he looks like he's been – you know, he don't look like a rookie. He's riding by himself. So you know, he has a way that he does police work.
Well,
his sector, and you know, I'd be surprised if he gets days off.
Oh, he's gonna get something.
I bet you he gets retrained.
He's gonna get something.
I bet you he gets retrained
and
he gets
retrained with discipline.
And he's gonna get a letter in his package, and he's gonna move on.
You get retrained in conjunction with other stuff.
He's gonna go sit in some sensitivity class like this,
with his arm folded, like when they send guys to the Museum of Tolerance. Hey, so listen, next week. We are going to be joined by our esteemed guest, Dr. Earl Ofari Hutchinson, and we've been waiting on this one. This is going to be good. He's got some pretty good. He's got an interesting, innovative idea that he's pushing forward, and I'd like to get some people's input on that. So, look down here. I'm pointing at the YouTube comments. Leave your comments in that section there. You can go to our Facebook page, which is Ride Along Radio Show. you can send us a tweet at Ride Along Radio, or you can send us an email to ridealongradioshow@gmail.com. If you've got questions, comments, or you see a topic that you'd like for us to tackle, we will certainly take all that into consideration.
Yeah, and in 2017, you're only going to be able to leave comments about George. So that's, so that's coming.
Well, there will hardly be any comments then. Sure. He's the one that pisses everybody
off. In 2017, that's what's coming. So, yeah.
Get your comments. Hey, you guys, Merry Christmas. Happy holidays. Happy Hanukkah. Happy Kwanzaa. Happy Ramadan. Ramadan's already come and gone, hasn't it?
Yeah, but I believe it does.
Happy High Holy Days. Happy holidays. And we'll see you guys next Thursday, which will be December 29th, right before the new year.
I wonder if that's the day I should – bring in the host of the Uncle Tom show that day?
Who is that, Armstrong Williams?
No.
Oh, well, Clarence Thomas is busy. He's rendering decisions and stuff.
No, I got another guy. He's a brother.
The host of Uncle Tom show.
Yeah, he's got the Uncle Tom.
Oh, he's running HUD now.
He's a
right, he's running HUD now. You're right. He's been named the Secretary of Housing and Urban Development.
No, not quite.
Not that one?
Not quite.
Oh, okay.
Not quite.
There's more. Believe me, the list goes on. All right.
We'll see.
Yeah, get that guy to come in. But we're going to have Dr. Omar Farr Hutchinson.
I don't want to do that to Dr. Hutchinson.
Yeah, we'll bring your guy in next time. He'll be the first.
The first one in 2017.
First one in 2017. There you go. All right, folks. Well, until next week, I'm George Holt.
I'm Gil Contreras, and you're not.
And shout out to OG POTUS, producer, and intern Darren, who's joined us tonight. And we'll catch you guys next week on the Ride Along Radio Show.
And Ed in Colorado.
Ciao. Express.